you had an amazing second set of sessions and you already know what to do. Let us know how you're feeling in the chat. We will be reading those comments for sure.
And we are so, so, so excited to introduce y'all to our musical performances. Mm-hmm. We've had some special friends and artists record special performances. So allow us to introduce them.
There is Sydney Agudong, AKA Jayne Doe. She is a top liner, vocalist, and also under Freight Train Media. Also, she's an on-screen lead in TV and film with credits including Infamously in Love, West Michigan, and a recurring guest star on Netflix's On My Block. You can follow her at Who is Jayne Doe?
Also performing is Vijay Rosales. Vijay is a Filipino-American singer-songwriter. He is from the Greater Los Angeles area. Vijay sings as part of the hit Filipino-American group called The Philharmonic, and as the music director has arranged and directed 8 riff-offs on The Late Late Show with James Gordon. Vijay continues to write and arrange music and teach worldwide. You can follow him on at Vro Music on Instagram, YouTube, and TikTok. Let's welcome our performers.
Hi, my name is Sydney Agudong. I go by Jayne Doe, and I am extremely excited to perform here. I come from a Filipino heritage, and for a while it took me a little bit to fully accept that part of me. And with the hate crimes that are going on, it's insane to see us still fighting. We're all one community, and I think that we need to make that known. We're here to love, not to hate, and it's sad to see that we're still trying to fight against that. Despite what we look like, we're all going through the same struggles, and that's kind of why I chose the songs I did today.
Used to wanna be the life of the party, but now everybody is gone. And all I want is a friend or a lover to help me remember how good this all could be. 'Cause I don't even know where to start. I think I left my brain for a work of art in Hollywood. And if I'm moving so, I hope that I go far. Like me better broke than with a broken heart. But this is Hollywood. Friends and I miss them, but if I'm being honest though, I'm kind of proud of my progress, 'cause I was losing a hold of myself. Oh, don't go chase off good feelings, you know all of the reasons you're here. It should be music to your ears, but I don't need. These spies. this is Hollywood. Yeah, I'm in Hollywood, baby.
I'm Vero, and I'm a Filipino-American singer-songwriter from the Los Angeles area. As I started writing music, I remembered trying to please others and trying to write music that would hit versus writing music when being my true self. And I just remember being really nervous and really anxious to put that out there. But when I started being myself, when I started being true to myself, I realized that I was writing the best music that I could possibly write. So basically, just be yourself and be true to yourself, and everything else will follow.
Woke up feeling, can't stop missing you.
lost my rhythm, stuck inside the blue. Just take it slow.
survive. So we can vibe forever.
Bring it down. Yeah.
Thank you so much to all of our musical performers for gifting us with your talent.
And right now we are going to move into our fireside chat. We are so honored to share with you that we've had a chance to chat with someone who is a true powerhouse in not only our community, but the New York State Assembly. I'm talking about Assemblymember Yuh-Line. Assemblymember Yuh-Line is a powerful, progressive leader for low-income immigrant and working families. She immigrated to the U.S. as an infant when her parents came from Taiwan with all of their possessions in just six suitcases. Yuh-Line stands up to systemic corruption and negligence and is a powerful voice for tenant protections, affordable housing, consumer protection, long-term pandemic planning, and fair taxation of the ultra-wealthy. She also helped form New York State's first ever Asia Pacific American Legislative Task Force. You can follow her at Yuh-Line on Twitter.
Hi, everyone. My name is Rosanna Gao, and I am a first year at Yale interested in theater, business, and policy, as well as the interdisciplinary connection between the three industries. This past year, I was an alumnus of Act of Change's Youth Ambassador Program, where we collaborated with AAPI leaders, took part of mentorship programs, and created resources for the AAPI community. I also served on the Youth Equity Council for Changemakers this year, and I'm super excited to be here to interview the one and only Assemblywoman Yuh-Line Niou. Hi, Yuh-Line.
Hi.
Thank you so
Hi,
much.
Rosanna.
Hi, thank you so much for being here. Before we get deep into our conversation, would you just like to introduce yourself?
Sure. So my name is Yuh-Line Niou. I actually am the current sitting assembly member representing Lower Manhattan in the 65th District in New York State. So just wanted to say hello to everyone.
Yeah, that sounds super cool. So I know you've done a lot of kind of like advocacy with like the AAPI community. What do you think are some of the most critical challenges facing the AAPI community and AAPI youth today?
So I think, you know, probably everybody in this audience can relate a little bit, but in my office, one of the biggest things that we have seen is a need for language access. A lot of folks probably were their parents' first translators. I myself was definitely my parents' first translator. But I think that a lot of times, you know, we've seen, you know, a lot of seniors, folks who need a little bit of extra help, folks who have English as their second language, or just, you know, understanding how to navigate systems. You know, I think that that's been really one of the biggest things that we've seen, you know, constituent service-wise is one of the biggest needs. We're also seeing that there has been obviously a lot of discussion on, you know, safety, right? When it comes to what is real community safety for our communities, what are some of the things that, you know, folks are seeing, especially with this huge rise in anti-AAPI sentiment and hate. And I think that it's been really important for us to have those discussions as a community, because I think that a lot of times there is a conflict for our communities when it comes to what safety looks like, because, you know, a lot of times people want a very, very simple answer, immediate thing that will help us to be able to regain our safety. But that is actually not existent, because the hatred, the anti-Asian sentiment, the racism is so deep, and it's historic. And the things that you know, people are seeing as an effect of it, it needs to be rooted out, you know, systemically, right? And I think that that's where, you know, we have to do certain things in our communities to keep ourselves safe in a lot of different ways. But also education is so important. So when we're talking about, you know, also making sure that there's Asian American history taught in schools, that's one of the best ways to be able to show that, look, Asian Americans belong here, right? Because we're constantly combating the two things that people probably talk about a lot, which is the model minority myth and perpetual foreigner syndrome, right? But really, they're kind of two sides to the same coin in a lot of ways, because, you know, they're just ways to keep us from getting the services and the help that we need, right? So one of the biggest repercussions of the model minority myth is saying like, oh, well, you guys are doing so well, so we don't need to help you, right? We don't need to provide you services. We don't need to include you in our social services. We don't need to be able to make sure that we're doing outreach to our communities that might need us, right? Because you're doing so well, quote unquote, right? And then there's also the perpetual foreigner, you know, syndrome, right? Which makes it so that they say, well, you're not one of us, so we don't need to help you. These are all different ways for people not to actually include us in any of the conversations, any of the representation, any of the solutions, right? And I think that that's one of the things that hurts us. And so when we're talking about, you know, making sure that we can have the resources that we need, we also have to make sure that we have representation to get those resources. So that's something that our Asian American community really has to have a discussion about, because when we're talking about, you know, social services and why we need them, people don't realize, even with the model minority myth, like, you know, being such a strong, I think, stereotype that makes it so that we're basically internalizing our oppression, we are seeing that in actuality, 1 in 4 Asian Americans here in New York, for example, is living in poverty. We have a lot of hidden poverty that makes it so that we can, we need to understand like where it's coming from in order to be able to fix, and that's systemic. And so by buying into, or by, you know, accepting some of these stereotypes or something that hurts us, you know, that makes it so that, you know, we're not actually fixing the systemic parts of the problem. So these are some of the biggest things that I think I see within our Asian American community that's really harming us, right? And I think that when we're hiding that poverty, and then when we're having a lack of representation, then we don't even have the people to be able to talk about it. So something that people probably don't know is that here in New York, for example, we have about 13% of our population is Asian American, and yet we have less than 2% of the representation. So it's really important for us to have more representation on the federal level as well. We have about 9% of our country's population, and yet we have less than 1% of the representation in Congress. So this is why it's so important for us to be able to have elected officials to bring our perspective to the table.
Yeah, so I know you definitely mentioned a lot of like the issues facing the AAPI community, and I'm sure with like the work you've done, you've definitely tried to kind of like fight those obstacles. I was just wondering, like, how did you end up deciding to run for office, and is this like a path you would recommend young people to consider?
So, I mean, this is obviously a very hard path, but I think that, you know, it's so, like I was saying, it's so important for us to have our perspective at the table. And I think that people don't realize that, you know, for example, women have just as much chance as men to win office if we run for it, but we tend to self-select out. And this also happens with as communities of color, people of color. And I think that within our Asian American community, we also have this tendency to have higher expectations for our own elected officials. And I think that it's really important for us to also be able to have a unification of our perspectives and our communities in order to be able to kind of help to be able to get more representation. But I definitely think that it is important for people to run for office. I myself decided to run for office for a lot of different reasons. And I think that a lot of people, you know, probably think the same way as I did as a young person. But when I was younger, I always thought that government was this thing that was kind of like untouchable, right? This like kind of ephemeral entity where laws and rules, regulations, they just happen to me and I don't get to choose any of it. And I think that a lot of people probably feel that way. And sometimes it can be, you know, it end up feeling a little bit of despair, maybe helplessness when something is unjust. And then also you feel like, oh, I don't know how to fix that. If something you see is very clear, like, you know, how do I pass this law? How do I change this for everyone? How do I make it so that it's a little bit more fair for everyone? But I think that, you know, as I started to question a lot of those things for myself, I decided that I wanted to become an intern in the Washington State Legislature. I decided that I wanted to see how government worked. So I took on this internship and was like very curious to basically get a bird's eye view in order to kind of see how everything worked. But I really just had the intention of like doing advocacy work and being able to basically break the system. You know, I was like, this isn't working for anyone. You know, these things are unfair. And as a kid, I was always like, this is not fair. This is not fair. This is not fair. Yeah. I was that kid. And so, you know, so I saw a lot of these injustices kind of pile up for my parents, for the communities that, you know, I saw needed help the most. I was very frustrated with, you know, some of the predatory lending schemes that I saw happening with some of the redlining and like things like car insurance that were just so frustrating to see. You know, you see somebody who, you know, is literally like one of the best drivers and like perfect driver, and yet their premium for their car insurance is like higher than some like dude with a DWI, and you're like wondering why. It's like, well, it's because this is a Asian uncle, and like that person was like a white guy whose parents have a really perfect credit score, and like the Asian uncle literally immigrated here and doesn't have a credit score or credit history. And so then you start to see like, oh, this is how redlining happens, and you get frustrated, you know, you want to stop that, you want to end that. And so that's where, you know, that kind of curiosity that I had came in of like, oh, how do I change these things? How do I make this different? How do I change the law? How do I change, you know, how people are treating us or how systems are unfair? And I took on that internship and I realized like, oh my gosh, it's actually a huge myth that you can't touch government. You can totally touch government. Yeah. It's just that people don't realize that they can. And so the people who are in power, they want to stay in power. And then so they basically make it so that it seems like you can't reach that power.
Yeah.
And so then they perpetuate a cycle that makes it harder for people to actually, you know, reach out. You know, this is why there's voter suppression. This is why there are laws that allow for, you know, congressional members to, you know, self-fund by so much. There's like literally like, this is why, you know, people just want it to seem like only an elite few can actually be your government. And yet, you know, in actuality, you know, people can vote, people can exercise their rights, and people can decide to change how their government looks, feels, is. And I think that we can do that together. And so that's why I decided to run for office, because I felt like after I started to work in the legislature, I worked in the legislature for and staffed a lot of members for 15 plus years. And so that's when I realized like, we have so little representation and we desperately need to make sure that people who understand how government works can help to make sure that we break that myth and help our communities to be able to advocate for themselves.
Yeah, that's really inspiring. What is like your favorite part of your job? And I also mentioned, I know that you mentioned earlier that there's like a lot of difficulties. What is the hardest part of your job?
Yeah, so I think that the hardest part is also the best part, right? Mm-hmm. I think that my favorite part of the job is definitely, you know, the constituent work. Working with people, figuring out what their needs are, talking to them, learning their story, learning what they're going through so that we can help them and problem solve for them and be able to, I guess, figure out policy-wise how to, you know, think bigger and be able to impact more people who are going through the same thing. So if you're seeing like constituent after constituent after constituent going through the same thing, not being able to find housing, having a difficult time, you know, getting their landlords to respond to them, having no hot water, no heat, or, you know, just being really stressed out about the high cost of groceries, or, you know, not understanding why they have to pay, you know, a certain price for being, you know, a senior in the area, like, you know, not knowing how to access certain services. Like, why is that? Like, a lot of people who were Chinese speaking did not understand that they could actually qualify for the 9/11 healthcare system. You know, like, there's things that, you know, you just started to see and see and see. And so it's only like with the problem solving that I was able to, you know, kind of see like, oh, this is my favorite part of the job. It's to help people and impact people's lives to make it better. Right. But I think like the hardest part is also seeing what people are going through. So it's like, you know, you see like, oh, wow, you know, constituent after constituent came into your office and they have nasal cancer, esophageal cancer. Somebody who never got victims compensation for what they went through down here in lower Manhattan for 9/11. And like, just, you see like case after case after case, you know, black mold. Now their kids all have asthma. You know, a boiler didn't work. And now like this kid is like going to the ER all the time because he slept in the cold. You know, like this is what you start to see. And it's like, this is why it's so important for us to have advocates, right? This is why it's so important for our story to be told. And this is why it's so important for us to be able to have representation that actually cares about, you know, our people and doesn't just, you know, go to ribbon cuttings or whatever, but it's like actually going and helping to make sure that their constituents get the services that they need.
Yeah, definitely. I know that you mentioned that like you saw like the issues that were affecting you and your community, and that you interned at this like at this place where you like learned more about like government regulations and stuff like that. So do you have any advice for young people looking to become more involved in activists and change makers? How did you like find your internship, like find these opportunities?
So I was very stubborn and I knew that, you know, I knew that in Washington State, the capital of Washington State was Olympia. So I chose my college based off of the fact that I was in Olympia and I wanted to be able to have a legislative internship so that I could see how things worked. And I was very determined. But I think that, you know, it's different for everyone, you know, but I think that, you know, putting yourself out there, joining, you know, something that you think is, you know, maybe an issue that you care about, or like, if you care about, you know, whether or not the school lunches are, you know, healthy, or if you care about climate change, or you care about, you know, join an organization, or join your community board, or join like some of the local organizing efforts for particular issues that you care about on the side that you care about, you know, and just like really get involved with that issue, or get involved with the community and get involved with the government in that way. And I think that it's also a way for you to be able to put your voice out there, and during election cycles, you know, find candidates you care about and campaign with them, you know, volunteer, intern, you know. For myself, I did an internship in the Washington State Legislature. We have internship programs throughout the, you know, city council, throughout the state legislature, through congressional offices. But I think that it's really important for folks to kind of reach out and don't be afraid to ask. You know, I think that that's one of the biggest things for our young people, because every opportunity is what you make of it. And whenever you're at any place of work, I think to pass on what my mentor always told me, which I only now really realize, like, you know, even though I took it to heart, that it was so powerful and so effective. And it's that you can lead from anywhere. You can lead from anywhere. You don't need a title. You don't need an office. You don't need a desk. You don't need a chair. You don't need a pencil or a piece of paper or anything. You can lead from anywhere. And know that there's lots of different types of leadership. And so, you know, every single time that you go into a space, like, think about where you can lead from and how you can lead from there.
Yeah, just out of curiosity, did you do any like civic engagement work in high school or middle school or like college, besides like your legislative internship?
Sure. I did a lot of different things. I even tried to start my own nonprofit organization as like a 10-year-old. Yeah. I thought it was a great idea, but it probably was not that well thought out. So I was starting this organization that I thought was just brilliant. I called it Kids Help Kids. I was a kid at the time, so I was like, help kids. And my mom was a nurse, and I was always volunteering at the hospital. I was candy striping. I was like, but you know, as a kid, you know, as a 10-year-old, like, or like 8-year-old or whatever I was at the time when I first started, like, you're, when you're candy striping or when you're volunteering at the hospital, that means you're playing with other kids. Like, you're just like, you're not actually there doing anything really like super, super, super hard. You're just like playing with other kids, you know, and but like they need somebody to play with, you know, they need somebody to tutor them in homework or whatever. So I was always in my mom's side of the hospital, and she worked in pediatrics, and she also worked in the maternity ward. And so in the pediatrics part, there was the kids with leukemia, and one little girl, I have a hard time talking about it at the same time. I tell the story, but it's really hard for me sometimes because I still remember all of the emotions that came with it. But all she wanted before she died, and she knew she was going to die, was to get her mom a present, you know?
Yeah.
And she wanted her mom to have something that she could remember her by. And so we started a group. And she also wanted my hair, so I gave her my hair, but I didn't realize that. I cut off all my hair.
Did you just, like, cut it by yourself and, like...
No, my mom helped me to go get it cut, but, like, I didn't realize that you needed, like, 3 batches of hair to make a wig. Like, they and you had to, like, send it away, you know. I didn't realize that as a kid. I just was like, okay, she likes my hair,
my hair. That's funny.
But so she wanted to give her mom a present, and you know, so we, you know, I was also like very, very, very like, I still am, I'm hugely very environmentally conscious. And so I was somebody who was just like, I need to save the environment. I literally had in my back pocket like 50 things kids can do to save the earth, like, or whatever. It was just like a book that Scholastic's book fair had, and I was obsessed with it. And so, you know, I was thinking, you know, why don't I start this organization that would be able to go, we would recycle cans. I was just like one of those like Chinatown canners ladies, but I was doing it for the environment. And I was like, we're gonna go collect cans, and we're going to go and use those deposit money. And then that money is going to be given to, you know, the kids who apply for this gift money so that they can buy their parents a present. And it, I thought it was such a good idea.
Yeah, it's a pretty good idea. Yeah.
I thought it was brilliant, but I did not account for the fact that I was growing up in El Paso, Texas, where in the summertime, where kids can like actually get together and do stuff, it was 110 degrees. So we were out there, me and a bunch of 10-year-olds, we were out there like getting cans, getting bottles from like ditches, from like bus stops, whatever. And one of my friends, whose parents did not allow her to play with me anymore, got heat stroke. And so she like passed out. And so that broke up pretty quickly. And the organization didn't go anywhere. And as you can imagine, we didn't get a lot of fiscal sponsorship. But I also realized at the end of the day that if, and by the way, we like, we got the money for one kid, but like, it was like, at the end of it, like, I realized that if we just, we had 10 kids, and if we had just asked every single parent for like $5, we would have raised just as much money. But it was an attempt. And so I just think that, you know, don't always just, hindsight's 2020, don't always give up on your ideas. But I think that it's really good to be thoughtful and make sure that nobody gets heat stroke.
Yeah, definitely. I think definitely taking initiative. That's so funny. All right. Last question. What advice would you give to adults and those with power on how to better listen to or partner with youth?
I mean, you just mentioned it. It's really like, listen, right?
Yeah.
My mom was super encouraging, even when when she was just like, I think that there are some holes in your programming. But she actually like, she like was took me very seriously, and she thought it was a really, really like sweet idea, I think, and bought us a cheesecake so that we could have our board meeting, you know.
A board meeting.
Yeah, it was like a partners meeting with me and the 10 kids. So my friend Jamie, she's actually lives in Brooklyn now, but we grew up together in El Paso, Texas, and she lives in Brooklyn now, but she still remembers all the hours that we put in trying to get cans from the airport, like how many times, like our parents must have drove us everywhere, and you know, but listen to your kids, listen to kids, you know, like understand where they're coming from, and you know, encourage our young people to make the change that they want to see, you know. And I think that a lot of times, you know, I'm always just startled and astounded by some of the ideas that young people have. And as folks probably saw, you know, when I ran for Congress just this last session, we had like over 1,000 volunteers, and the majority of them were young people. And it's because we care about, you know, what it is that young people think. And I think that the reason why folks are asking me this question is probably because, you know, a lot of times we don't see campaigns like that. We don't see offices like that. My office, my chief of staff was with me when he wasn't, since he was an intern in Assemblymember Ron Kim's office, and I was the chief of staff. And he was 19 years old when he first started. And, you know, he's been with me ever since. And we've been together for now almost 8 years. And I think that, you know, it's really incredible to see what young people can do. And, you know, I remember starting as a young intern, and I had so much ability, and yet lots of people were not willing to give me the chance, right? Yeah. To be able to do things and have impact and, you know, even write policy. And I have to say that, you know, I've always been somebody who now I, very much keep that in mind every single time that I am, writing policy. And a lot of my, young people are the ones who are actually looking at the policy, thinking it through, figuring out, you know, how to make it better. And so I work a lot with groups like Sunrise. I work a lot with young people and triage, you know, working on those environmental bills. And I work a lot with, you know, our young AAPI community when we're talking about, you know, issues that are important to us, such as language access, translation services for everyone. You know, people were like telling me, well, we have to make sure that we have these organizations, and telling us like what's really working, you know, hey, put it on your TikTok, you know, make sure that your TikToks have, you know, alt text, right? Like just things that people are thinking through are really, really helpful, right? And I think that our young folks are thinking broader and bigger. And what we have to do is listen. And that also gives them the ability to be able to make that change. And then in the future, even what, I mean, we are doing all this work to quote unquote pave the way, right? And so we have to give them and build that pipeline to make sure that they have the opportunities to be able to take that path when we want them to. And like, and when they want to, you know, and I think that it's really important to do that. Build the pipeline and don't just like say that you're paving the way.
Yeah. All right. Thank you so much for this conversation. Your words are like truly so inspiring. Like after this, I'm gonna join like a local like civic engagement club or something.
Just you can start up Kids Help Kids.
Yeah, I know. I should just start I did in my local community. No, we can make this like a nationwide 501c3, like your nonprofit. It was such a pleasure to talk to you, and I'm sure that all of our listeners, including me, learned a lot. We're super grateful for you taking your time, and we're so excited to follow you as a leader within our community. So thank you again. Yeah.
So good to talk to you, Rosanna.
Hi.
Bye.
Welcome back, everybody. How great was that conversation with Assemblymember Yuh-Line? She is literally so freaking wise, and we thank her so much for her time. Give it up for her again in the comments, because those were pearls of wisdom she was dropping.
And we are so excited because we are coming up on our third and final round of breakout sessions.
Yes.
So these facilitators have been waiting to get to meet y'all. So go ahead and enjoy your last breakout of the day.
Yes, and make sure to come back because we have so much more in store for you. Maybe even a little bit of surprise here and there. Ooh. And we will see you in 1 hour. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
let's give a huge round of applause for all of our breakout session facilitators. They have worked so hard to make this accessible to all of you over Zoom, because as we know, we've been living in that Zoom culture, and it is so tough to organize so many different aspects of that technology. So we thank them so much for all the hard work that they have put into this.
Up next, we have our final keynotes and remarks, plus a closing conversation on intergenerational activism. These speakers are so amazing and so inspirational for all of us. They are making powerful, impactful change in their communities. We have Estella, Owoimaha-Church. Estella is an award-winning educator, activist, advocate, artist, and union leader. As a first-generation American of Samoan and Nigerian descent, Estella advocates for all who look like her, is an ally for others in the margins, and forges paths for young people where there are none. She is currently the executive director of EPIC, or Empowering Pacific Islander Communities. Some of you may have gotten the chance to sit in on her breakout session today, but she's also here to talk about her activism and advice to the next generation of AAPI activists. You can follow her on Twitter and Instagram.
Next, we'll hear from Andrea Hailey, CEO of Vote.org, the nation's largest nonpartisan digital voter engagement organization. Vote.org has helped more than 4.4 million people register to vote and more than 3.3 million request mail-in ballots in all 50 states. Andrea is an expert on civic engagement and a staunch defender and promoter of democracy. Her work has been featured in the New York Times, the Washington Post, NPR, and Bloomberg. You can follow her on Twitter and Instagram at Andrea E. Hailey. Please welcome our speakers.
Estella Leilani Afiekong Tabita Owoimaha-Church. A name I had to run drills to keep straight. Couldn't spell it till I was 8 and had to build a life with my partner to punctuate. A burden is what my name felt like for most of my life until my journey to self grew to include all of my ancestors, their legacies, DNA strands that form rememories, until my love of self included all avenues and intersections at which I exist. Until the weight of gifting a name worthy of the universe that I had birthed became heavier than any guilt or shame I ever tied to my mouthful of a name. I am Leilani Tavita with roots in Satufia, roots in Sale Lua and Tiapapata, eldest of three, the firstborn of the firstborn, granddaughter of two high chiefs, Afiegan of House Owima Akpan, first of her name, daughter of where mermaids lay, across rivers, under waterfalls, and along the moonlit beaches of Calabar. Descendant of wayfinders, cultivator of visions, indigenous scientist, designer of bridges, connecting the past, present, and future. I'm a mother now, and my journey to self is tied to hers. The universe requires I navigate safely. So I dig deep, root down, reach back, but continue to labor forward. Thank you for listening. Talo Falava, Malasoy Fua, and I feel mine. Olo Oingoa O, Estella O Church. Greetings and welcome to Changemakers Summit 2022. My name is Estella Owoimaha Church. My pronouns are she, her, oops, born and raised on Tongva land, for now known as South Los Angeles. I happen to be Executive Director of Empowering Pacific Islander Communities, or EPIC. And I am very excited to join you all today to share how much of my work as a community leader and educator and advocate is very much linked to how well I've come to understand myself, who my ancestors are, and a land that has raised me both here and abroad. The poem I just shared was once only 3 lines long. As my identity process has grown, shifted, and changed, and continues to evolve, so has this piece that I often use to introduce myself, who I'm from, and where I call home. As I learn more about who I was meant to be, I have more to say and more to add to this piece. As the voyage that I'm on to discover who I am and to know myself and what legacies have helped to shape my existence, as I continue this voyage, I imagine this piece will also continue to evolve. It's a work of art that will never quite be finished. I, a work, that should never be quite finished. I offer this poem to you, a metaphor. Who you are, who you will become, and who you were meant to be. It's a process, a learning process. It's a voyage that will never be quite finished. At least that's my hope for you all. An artist can work on a piece for an entire lifetime and never feel as though it's done or ready for public consumption. Some pieces you create may live on forever, and some might need revisions and several rounds of editing, and that's okay. Allow what could easily be an identity crisis to become your voyage. Trust. I know that is easier said than done. I am Black, Pacifica, Samoan, Nigerian, Angelino, cis woman, mother, sister, spouse, leader, advocate, artist, educator, and more. When I took Black women writers as an Africana studies major, an undergraduate at Cal State Northridge, and I read the work of Audre Lorde for the first time, I felt a ton of weight leave my chest. Her work has impacted my art, the ways I choose to lead, and where I serve. More importantly, Audre Lorde's work has helped me continue to navigate my diaspora voyage. And so I want to share three pieces of hers that have helped ground me and remind me of who I am and what my purpose is. In a speech, Audre introduces herself as a Black lesbian mother war poet, doing my work, coming to ask you if you are doing yours. Reading this brought a major shift to how I navigated my identity voyage. For the first time, I saw myself as a whole person and no longer felt as though I had to choose a side, Black or Samoan. I could, in fact, be my whole self all the time, as I choose, unapologetically. And that this idea was also true in the reverse. I came to understand that part of my work, my kuleana, tautua, my responsibility is to continue working on me. In an essay, Poetry is Not a Luxury, Audre asserts that poems are a vital necessity of our existence. According to her, it's where our hopes and dreams of change and survival live. Poetry and other art mediums help us make thoughts into tangible actions. Lorde says that poetry is the way we help give a name to the nameless so it can become thought. And when we act as poets, we help document our everyday experiences. In A Litany for Survival, which is one of my favorite Audre Lorde poems, she talks about a type of courage many Native Hawaiian and Pacifica people can relate to. In the final stanza of this piece, she writes, "When we speak, we are afraid. Our words will not be heard nor welcomed. But when we are silent, we're still afraid. So it is better to speak, remembering we were never meant to survive." Whenever I read that piece, scripture for me, I'm reminded of Lototele, a Pacifica concept that reminds us our courage is loud. And it's loud because our communities have been silenced for far too long, but that our courage is also joyous. Because when we raise our voices against injustice, it is indeed a celebration. This loud, joyous celebration represents the best parts of our humanity and emboldens others to join us. All that you are, as young people, as artists, as storytellers, as queer inclusive communities of color, as influencers and folks who hold some privilege and power, all you offer when you enter a space are gifts to each of your respective communities. Gifts on gifts handed down to us from generations before. When we welcome our ancestors into whatever space we're in and tend to the relationships between each of us through all the challenges and the celebrations, when we prioritize gratitude and humility and solidarity becomes a tangible verb, collectively, we move closer to fulfilling our promise, our tautua, our kuleana, our responsibilities to lead by service with love. And we get to do that through the arts and as our whole selves. All that I am is who I am from. Where I am from is who I promise to serve. Throughout today's conference, consider who has contributed to all that you are, including the land that has raised you. What gifts will you share with our community? And as you begin to take up space authentically and unapologetically, as you share your stories with others, and as you express your courage out loud, enjoy the voyage. Thank you so much for having me at this year's Changemakers Summit, and I hope that you enjoy the rest of today.
My name's Andrea Hailey, and I'm the CEO of Vote.org. And I'm so happy to be able to join all of you today. And I'm really excited about all the work that you've accomplished together and want to extend big gratitude to you for showing up and for really digging in on what's happening in our country today. I want to extend a congratulations to all the leaders and organizers of today's event. I'm so thankful to be able to offer a few words of encouragement as we close out and reflect on the best practices learned that will help energize the AAPI community just 1 week out from this very important election. Look, I'm gonna be honest. We have two types of people in our country right now. Those who believe in a healthy and thriving democracy where every voice is heard, and those who believe in some other style of government where only those with already entrenched power are heard. That's why this midterm election is so, so important. It's really setting the chessboard for whatever is to come in our democracy. So as you know, the AAPI community is one of the fastest growing populations in the United States. And AAPI voter registration has increased by 51% between 2008 and 2016, compared to 8% nationally. A 51% increase in AAPI voters is a tremendous number. But behind that increase, you'll find the motivated individuals, family members, neighbors, communities, all working together to ensure that the voice of the AAPI community is heard in our democracy and at the ballot box. And of course, like any community, the AAPI community is not a monolith. There's incredible diversity within each letter in that acronym, and we in the democracy building community need to understand this and act accordingly. In 2020, more than 39 million people used Vote.org's tools to register to vote, to request a vote by mail ballot, to find accurate nonpartisan voting information. And we want to be a partner to the next generation of civic leaders in your community. And we want to help on-ramp the next generation throughout the country into our democracy. At Vote.org, we use technology to simplify political engagement and to break down barriers to voting, especially for young people. We know that friends and family care about what's happening in communities, but that we have different laws in all 50 states in this country around voting. And that sometimes those different laws can cause complications that create a situation where we often see up to 15% drop-off in midterm election years. That's why Vote.org has made it easy. You can check your polling location, you can register to vote in under 2 minutes, and you can use our tools and resources to go out into the community and register as many people as possible. You can sign up for election alerts that allow for get out the vote alerts that will tell you when the election is happening and how you can participate. This opportunity to participate cannot be taken casually. Some of the more consequential policies and decisions being made in our country today are made at the local and state level. We have over 27 secretaries of state running for office this election cycle. There are over 30 races for governor. Several judicial elections are going to be decided, as well as a third of the Senate and all of the House of Representatives. So this is an important election, but other than that, up and down the ballot, there'll be tons of local elections that are also happening that will really impact people's daily lives the most. When you vote, you're engaging in our democracy and shaping the future of all of our communities. I know that voting can sometimes be easier said than done. I get it. I'm from Indianapolis, Indiana, where I cannot vote by mail because I'm not 65 or older. And my polling location last election had 6 and 7 hour lines. But I'm telling you that I personally am here to partner, and vote.org is here to partner so that we get through all of this together and we build a democracy where one day we see 80% voter turnout in this country and where no voter has to stand in lines for more than 30 minutes at a time. We know that we have the capability in this country to build systems that can get everyone through the voting process in the easiest and most streamlined way possible. We just are currently lacking the political will to do so. But that can change if we all show up and we all work together to continue to stay resilient in our democracy. So as you continue to reflect on the lessons you've learned over the last period of time and the friendships gained and the next steps after this event, I encourage you to visit vote.org before you vote. We have information on deadlines and policies in your state. And after you do that, you can go to iamvoteready.org, which will help you make the plan to vote. And while you're there, grab some social media graphics. We're encouraging everyone to share and help their friends to get prepared to vote as well. Go out there and be the vote captain in your own family, in your own life, on your own street. I'm certainly the vote captain of my friends and family, calling them all the time. Once I have the information that I need, I make sure that everyone else does too. And I encourage you all to do the same. Everything you do will seem like it's not enough, but all of it is important. So after you go to iamvoteready.org and you've spent time on vote.org, we also have a brand new ballot tool at vote.org that we're rolling out that will help you to see what's on your ballot. You can download the list of who's running for office and the issues that are happening, and you can download them right there on your phone. And most importantly, please remember to vote on or before November 8th, whether it's voting by mail or it's voting in person. Need you to make that plan and intentionalize how you're going to participate. You're here today because you already understand the vital importance of this work. Deep down, you already know why this midterm election cycle is so important. And you know that we're going to have to keep showing up time and time again to make sure access to the ballot box is protected. We want to buck the trend of fall off during the midterm elections, and we want to keep AAPI voter turnout numbers up and strong. Together, we can all meet this critical moment in our country's history, and we could do it one vote at a time. No matter how wonderful our vote.org team is and platform is, we can't do this work alone, and we can't do it without all of you. And I'm so heartened every single day when I see so many people show up, care, dig in, and do the work. Collectively, anything is possible. So thank you very much for inviting me. Thank you for taking the time out of your day. Thank you for how you show up for your friends and family. Go out there and be a vote captain. And from my heart to yours, I wish you all the luck in the world and look forward to seeing you again on the other side of this midterm.
Thank you so much to our keynote speakers. We are so grateful for them, for their wisdom. And I am feeling so inspired now. I don't know about you, but thank you again. And it just makes me so excited about the next generation of AAPI leaders and youth activists and the positive change that's going to come from everyone who has come today.
Yes, it has really been a transformational day for all of us, not just us here, but I also hope for you at home. And to close this out, we are going to have our closing conversation that is really centered around intergenerational activism. So we have Mina Fedor interviewing Soukprida Phetmisy.
Mina, our interviewer, is an incredible youth activist. She co-founded AAPI Youth Rising as a middle school student. AAPI Youth Rising organized a rally in Berkeley in 2001. to raise awareness about anti-Asian hate. They expected maybe 70 people to show up. Instead, over 1,200 people showed up. Since then, she was a finalist for Time Magazine's Kid of the Year and has been recognized by President Biden and the White House for their work in support of inclusive education. You can follow her and the rest of the AAPI Youth Rising team on Instagram at AAPI Youth Rising.
Soukprida Phetmisy is a queer Lao American activist, DEI capacity builder, teaching artist, and anti-racist, anti-bias organizer educator. Her passion for community, storytelling, and disrupting the status quo was catalyzed by a decade of organizing and advocacy in the arts and education sectors. She's now the director of AAPI Alliances at Teach for America, where she works in coalition with community leaders to strengthen the leadership of Asian American, Native Hawaiian, and Pacific Islander educators, students, and their communities. You can follow her at Soukprida on all social channels.
We're so excited to hear this conversation between Mina and Soukprida.
Hi, everyone. My name is Mina Fedor, and I'm the founder of AAPI Youth Rising. As activists, we organized a rally in Berkeley, California in 2021 with the hope of raising awareness to the increase of anti-Asian xenophobia. We hoped that maybe 70 people would show up, but instead over 1,200 showed up to support. Since then, we've been recognized for our work advocating for inclusive education all over the country. Today, I'm thrilled to be interviewing Soukprida today about intergenerational activism. Changemakers is all about making activism something that any of us in the AAPI community can do. It can be scary knowing how to start, but it's a good thing we're not alone in this work and we can all learn from each other. Please join me in welcoming Soukprida. Hi, Soukprida. Can we start by having you introduce yourself?
Thanks, Mina. Hi, everybody. My name is Soukprida Phetmisy. I use she, they pronouns. I am based out of Chicago, Illinois, which is the ancestral and traditional lands of the Odawa, Ojibwe, and Potawatomi. I've actually been based here for over a decade. And so this is where I do my community building, my community work, where I find cultural warmth and all of that. My day job, I lead Teach for America's Asian American and Pacific Islander Alliances. And so a lot of the work that has brought me to this space is actually in the education sectors, fighting for educational equity, and also working with young people and older folks to understand how we are best connected. And so I have an organizing background, an arts background, and am really interested in kind of just exploring how folks can really make education equity a big issue in their lives.
Yeah, that sounds really amazing. So more on that, you spoke a little bit on what kind of work you're doing, but what does activism mean to you personally?
Yeah, this is, I've been thinking a lot about this question because it honestly changes often, the answer. At first, when I got introduced to even just the idea of activism, I was a college student back in the early 2000s. I went to an art school, much to the dismay of my parents. They really wanted me to be a doctor or a lawyer. But through the arts, I met a lot of people who looked like me, particularly Laotian American folks, who started to tell me a little bit more about kind of the issues that they were dealing with. And we started to connect in weird ways where, and I wouldn't say weird, but it was like, I wasn't expecting to connect with many folks on similar issues. And so they actually got me interested in learning about my own identity and developing like an understanding of like where I've come from, where like my family's come from, our introduction to the United States via war, especially. And so when I started to dig into that more, I realized I didn't have a lot of language to like explain what I was trying to figure out, but I knew that there were a lot of issues that mattered to me, particularly around like education attainment, as well as like immigration. I learned in college that Laotian Americans especially are not very likely to get a college degree. I think at the time I read a census report that said only 14% of Laotian Americans had a college degree. And I was like in the middle of my college experience being like, oh my gosh, I hope I can get this. And it actually fueled in me a way to like, I need to get active. I need to tell other folks about this this data point that we didn't know about, and started to like try to get resources that actually would support students who look like me to get to and through college. And so my activism really actually spurred because my own community said, like, hey, do you know what's going on within our own community? Let's get involved and let's talk about like the issues that are impacting us, even within our own families. And, you know, my brother actually never graduated from high school. And so it was a very personal mission for me to start getting involved in my community around like these issues. And through education and learning about those issues, I actually started to expand beyond that. And so I think activism for me really means like one, taking a beat to like collect and understand who I am in the my identity within like the country, and not just like my personal identity and my cultural identity, but also my political identity. Don't think I had a political identity until I started to meet other folks who were championing issues that I didn't know about. And so really, activism is like talking about that with like my own community and trying to figure out how to bridge gaps or build awareness and also get the resources and the power that we need to kind of make change in a small localized way that reverberates across the country. So I still think about it every day, like how my activism is evolving.
Yeah, for sure. That's a great story. And through your activism and through those experiences and finding your political voice and finding your voice in like as a whole, I guess what kind of lessons have you learned or where did you learn them from, and why do you think they're so important to you?
Gosh, so many lessons. I'm still learning them today. I think one of the biggest things I learned was that was how to like actually be a really good listener. A lot of times when in my early days of trying to just move with folks and move in community, I had a tendency to have my own ideas and be excited about like, did you know about this? Or like, have you heard about this issue impacting this community? And like kind of roll right through. And oftentimes like roll through a lot of communities too without taking a moment to just stop and take stock of like, who's been doing this work before me. You know, my eagerness and my excitement was coming from a good place, but the impact that it was having on the folks I was trying to build with was like, whoa, Sue, can you chill? Like back off, like we've been here. And so I think like one of the big lessons I've learned is that I had a lot of learning to do and to also like, you know, look more and reflect back on the past of what has happened, because oftentimes I realized that like, I would continue uncovering how Asian Americans, especially, and how Pacific Islanders have been organizing and, you know, resisting for so many years before I got here. So none of these issues were new. And so I knew I had to like learn the lesson of like, you need to take stock of what's been going on and really just build your understanding of what's come before you. And then that helps to kind of start to envision what a future could look like. So that was like a big lesson, was like constantly be reflecting back, look for the stories that are not mainstream, that often get invisibilized, that aren't told, but are actually always been there. And then I learned that particularly from trying to work with groups that were within the Asian American Pacific Islander communities that don't identify as Laotian American, who have different ethnic backgrounds than me, that while we are all under the moniker of Asian American Pacific Islander or AAPI, that we actually all experience oppression completely differently. And so while we have a political voice, I had to start understanding, even within my own community, the one that I was identifying with, like what other issues were there. And so I think that came from speaking to folks across different ethnic backgrounds, speaking with my Filipinx friends and trying to understand kind of the history of like how we're connected, speaking with, you know, Pacific Islanders that, you know, had completely different experiences from me. And then also sharing my experience in a way that doesn't, that finds the connections rather than the differences. And so I think that's, I learned a lot even within my own community of how to start doing that. And I think I will also say I spoke a lot to like my mom and my own elders, like my aunties, about just their experience here. The Laotian community is pretty young in their introduction to the United States. You know, we've only been here for 40-ish years. And so I was even asking them like the ways that they were experiencing just community work being here. And it gave me a lot of insight around like, oh, there's a lot of folks that actually have connections that aren't speaking to each other. And so I took that as like a big lesson to like constantly be trying to find the connections or finding ways to convene folks who have similar goals and aspirations.
Yeah, yeah, for sure. And building off of that, I guess what one of the hardest parts of activism is definitely coalition building, and specifically with people who might not have the same values as you or come from different communities or who might not 100% agree with you. So I guess what experiences have you had with that and how have you approached that kind of big facet of activism?
Yeah, thanks for asking this question. It's like one that I constantly think about and oftentimes, you know, I don't always get right. But I think it's a practice rather than like an in the moment, you're like, right, and here's how you coalition build and here's like the framework for it. So a lot of it is honestly based in relationships. And I would say like capital R relationships. It's like the one thing that I think about often. And within relationships, the one thing I've had to learn and learn the hard way is that as I've been coalition building, especially being a part of a team at Teach for America called the National Community Alliances, my colleagues respectively work across different communities. We have a Black Community Alliance, for example, a Native Alliance, our Immigration and Education Alliance, our PRISM Alliance that works with our LGBTQ community, our Latinx Alliance, and we all constantly chat about like, what's going on in your world? What's happening in there? How can I be supportive of you, but not like overtake the things that you are doing? Like, what are the ways that we're connected and our goals are aligned? And so especially that's easy when your values align, like you said, but your question was like, how do you do it with folks who misalign with you? And a lot of times for me, I like to take a step back and try to like really like center the person or the group's humanity first. Oftentimes, you know, for me, I go back to like my great value of empathy. And I try to like sit in that for a little bit and understand like, what does connect us? How can I see their humanity before I dive into the things that I need? And then start from there, trying to find like that goal that we have in common, that oftentimes is, you know, honestly, like wanting the same like resources or like in many ways trying to understand that we're building power to support one another. But the way we talk about an issue might be different or like our stance might be different. So like grounding or drilling down to like what really connects us. And then the second thing I often think about is I had to learn how to repair ruptures in relationships, especially in coalition building, you know, and especially in relationships when you really center relationships. I thought a lot about how like oftentimes like there's going to be rupture moments in a relationship and I'm going to have to learn how to apologize and make a really good apology and actually be accountable. And I think as somebody who often is trying to figure out like, how do I hold others to account, but then also how do I hold myself accountable, and how do I repair a relationship that potentially is that I've caused harm? Like, it's important for me to like move through that with grace and also with an understanding that relationships take time and there will be repair. And especially if our values are misaligned, to not completely close myself off to the person or the group, and continue trying to find ways that we are connected. We are aligned in our goals down the line. And so I think like learning how to repair relationships, especially if I'm the one who's causing harm, it's important for me to like make sure that I make those amends too.
Yeah, yeah, definitely, for sure. And I know another big challenge along with rebuilding relationships is sustainability and I guess avoiding burnout and I guess working with others around that as well. So I guess, how do you manage this in your day to day?
Oh my gosh. You know, I was just thinking about how, before we hopped onto this, you're telling me about your high school schedule and all the things you're taking on. And it made me think about even my day to day work, where especially, for me, I love taking a lot of things on. And I love saying yes to everyone. And oftentimes I say yes to everyone to the detriment of saying yes to myself and the things that I need to recharge. And so something I've been working on this year is this idea around like disciplined, like or at least disciplined boundaries and some disciplined joy to give myself moments to seek out joy, to like remain sustained in this work. For me, especially doing activism work, it can take a huge toll on just my mental health, my physical health. Some days, like, I used to wear it like a badge, and I would say, wow, I missed like a couple meals today because I was so into this issue or into this thing I was doing. And now I look back and I'm like, that is not how I want to like leave a legacy around how you actually get engaged in activism, right? And, you know, looking at young folks especially, I don't want to tell y'all like, hey, it's cool to miss a meal and like continue working on this work. It's also, you know, this work is for the long haul. So like, fine, go take a boba break, go get a drink somewhere, take that beat, because the activism work is not siloed work for me. Like, and it took me a long time to learn that, that I'm not doing this on my own, that if I need to tap out, that others should be able to be there to support me as well. And that's the kind of relationships and coalitions that I'm trying to build to help me sustain myself. And so on the like very basic level, I have a very hard out when I sign off of work. For example, I close my computer and I go cuddle my dog. I cook a meal with my partner. And then on another level, I'm trying to figure out ways to sustain just like constantly being in a place that my traumas can get triggered. And so I'm in therapy, of course. And I'm like one of the first in my family to openly talk about that. And I've noticed that it started to like trickle down to my nieces and nephews and even my sisters who are older than me, asking me like, how's that going for you? Do you think it would work for me? There's some things I feel hard, like it's hard for me to talk about. And so I think like, as I'm like building community and building, doing movement work across the country, I have to remember that like, I can also do that within my family and model ways to like, stay in tune with my body and listen in to the things that my body needs to rest and rejuvenate. And so I think, I've kind of given myself more grace to be like, if you need a tap out, that's actually a part of the work. You shouldn't be here like running ragged, because your community is going to also have your back in that. And I think like, that's where building those relationships come in, and also just, you know, being honest with yourself when you're listening to your body and being in sync with that to kind of help yourself stay sustained. I won't give advice around like, you know, here's like all the self-care tactics I take, because I think it's so personal for everybody, but I really like to think about like community care and community warmth and trying to go towards those things when I'm feeling a moment of like, I need a tap out and I don't want to tap out forever. I need a tap out right now so I can be stronger coming back in. So that's how I think about sustainability.
Yeah, that's really important. Really, really felt that with the like saying yes to everything. And I guess not really considering what you need to do for yourself. That's definitely been something that I've been trying to work towards that, especially because I am younger and it's important to keep it going, I guess, if I really want to and all that. So definitely
are there ways? Are there ways that you're thinking about your own sustainability?
I don't really know. I just sort of try to keep balance with school and my activism work, as well as just, I guess, having fun with my friends and also having like a social life outside of everything else. You know what I mean? So
real.
I definitely usually I take, it's kind of weird, but generally I have like Friday evening time that I can sort of do whatever, right? And I can hang out with my friends. Like it's always like a Friday evening. But yeah, I definitely felt that one. For sure. Yeah. And I guess another topic relating to like your self-growth within activism is, a lot of times people end up feeling sort of an imposter syndrome, like they don't deserve the recognition or they don't deserve, I guess, the accomplishments that they've achieved, or, like they're not smart enough or too young or too old or anything like that. So I guess, how have you sort of dealt with that, and how do you move forward in that mindset?
I think sometimes I still feel imposter syndrome sometimes. I had a moment even before this call where I was like, am I even the right person to be on this panel? And I was like laughing about it because sometimes, you know, I get into my own head and I tell these stories and these narratives about myself that honestly are not true to anybody else. And I realized that's like some healing work I still have to do for me. And so I'll take that to therapy and, you know, I won't put that on anybody to like help me unpack that. But the way that I think about imposter syndrome, like it was the first time I learned about imposter syndrome. I think I was newly in the education space, just trying to get like my feet on the ground and trying to understand like, what is this world? What is this sector? And I remember I didn't understand like the lingo. I didn't even understand the acronyms. I was like, whoa, I am so behind. It felt like I graduated from college and I didn't know what was going on. And I had that experience a lot, actually, like when I was going from elementary to middle school, I switched schools and I was like, wow, I don't feel like prepared for middle school at all. And then when I got to high school, I was like, holy cow, why are folks so ahead of me? I thought we were all just in middle school. And then I like got to college and I was like, everyone, you know, like, I think what I'm trying to say is comparison is honestly like, not the way to go about it. But I do think what I've realized about imposter syndrome is that, you know, in many ways, it's also very systemic and it's insidious, particularly in the ways we talk about, you know, our different identity markers. So like being a Lao woman, you know, I used to go into rooms for meetings and folks would be like, whoa, I've never met a Lao woman in my life. And I was like, oh my gosh, now I feel the pressure that I need to represent every single Lao person. And I don't think I can do that. I don't know everything. And I think like that to me fueled my imposter syndrome in like really bad ways. I was just like, okay, I guess I just got to do it. I have to like figure out how to figure this out. And then what I realized was, you know, I just had to be honest and say like, actually, I don't represent everybody. I also, you know, I here are some of my credentials without like credentialing, but it's also for me, just building kind of a better relationship with myself to know that like the work I'm putting in, the ways I've reflected, they have made a huge impact. And I think for me, it's like self-affirmation is an important way to validate that experience, but gosh, it can be hard. You know, did you watch Insecure? Have you seen Insecure before?
I have not. No.
Okay. There's Issa Rae, the main character, like speaks in a mirror and she's like rapping to hype herself up. And I was like, oh my gosh, does everyone have this experience where they like speak to themselves in the mirror to hype themselves up before like doing something that they feel like they're an imposter for? But I do think like the way I think about that is like the way we talk to ourselves and how we hype ourselves up or how we like support and validate ourselves from within. It's really helpful to combat that for me. So I do spend some times like in front of the mirror being like, Souk, you got this. You know, you got this. You know how you got this. Here are ways that I know you got this. And I think like that for me, it's like healing my inner child a little bit because I didn't often hear a lot of that type of praise or affirmation growing up. You know, I saw it through a lot of actions, but I think the words of affirmation and the self-validation is really helpful for me to kind of get over that. And then to know, like, for imposter syndrome, at least, I learned that it's also just very, it's just kind of built into, like, the systems that oppress us, too, in the ways that who gets to be, like, on mainstream platforms, who gets promoted, the faces that we often see in, like, leadership positions never look like me. And so I was like, where is the place for me? If that's where I want to go, can I get there? You know, and a lot of times it helped for me to seek out other folks who were aligned with me in their either career journey, activism journey, mental health journey, to understand like that I'm not alone. And so I think that feeling of not being alone helped me to kind of pull out of it too.
Yeah, definitely. Felt that one a lot too.
Yeah,
in terms of the like, I guess not knowing where you're supposed to belong and not feeling like you do belong there. That's definitely something that I've definitely struggled with in the activism sort of sense. Yeah. In a lot of ways. Very relatable. I guess, but pivoting a tiny bit here. Okay. What
I guess, what big challenges do you feel like are facing Asian American youth today? And how can we combat that? Or I guess, how can that be more, I don't know, well known, those specific challenges? And how can, I don't know, how do you feel that people can like mentor or help youth get through that?
Gosh, well, you know, I'm really resonating with what you just said, where like you feel like you experience imposter syndrome even within the activism space. And that to me, I feel very like, oh gosh, it means like me, I'm not doing enough to support even like making sure that y'all feel included in the activism space. And by y'all, I mean like young folks especially. And I know sometimes when we talk about like intergenerational activism, there can be this binary that is between like old or young, and that's it. But I really think about the like non-static nature of age. And so when I think about like the issues right now that I would want to, that I'm thinking about a lot, I also want to hear from you, Mina. There are like issues that you're like, you didn't even talk about this, or no one's talking about this, that we should champion more. Because I think like, that's kind of like the divide that I often see, is that, you know, we're trying to potentially just name for young people, like, here are your issues, go with it. I'm saying, I don't know a lot, but like based on the work that I do in education, you know, I really do see racism, the rise in discrimination as a big issue for Asian American youth, especially when it comes to bullying, belonging, or finding their place, even within, you know, schools, in their school community, and trying to figure out how to navigate that. And I think that then exacerbates another issue around mental health. And, you know, I know oftentimes it's in, at least in Laotian culture, Lao culture, it is very hard to talk about your mental health. You know, I was saying earlier, like, I'm the first in my family to be like, y'all, I'm going to therapy, and it is helping. And please don't say anything about that, you know? And it took many years for my family to be like, you have mental health. What is that even, you know? Because even the translation to the Lao language doesn't translate as directly. And so I've like had my nieces and nephews who are in early high school, middle school, even talk to me about like, I feel anxious about this. Is this normal to feel anxious about? I'm constantly worrying about this one thing and it's sticky. Or, you know, it's showing them that they can talk about that. So I think like mental health. And then I also think, you know, I have a lot to learn from young folks who are doing climate justice work. And I think that's an area where I really see young folks like y'all leading in that too. And so we want to make sure that there is a planet for y'all as you're getting older, and solidifying kind of like your identities and where you want to go and how you want to build. And so I think a lot of times, like, those would be the three big things that I would say are issues. But honestly, Mina, like, tell me if like there are things that you're also thinking about where you're like, I would love it if like, you know, older generations would also like shine a light on this, or like put this on their plates to work toward.
Yeah, I think mental health is definitely a big one, for sure. Definitely agree with that kind of thing. And those open discussions need to be, I guess, sort of made to be more normal and less, I guess, sort of like, oh, there's something wrong with you. Like, you know what I mean? Right. And yeah, I agree with you in the climate sense as well. Like, a lot of youth my age, a lot of my friends, and actually kids from my school too, have been really championing like the climate sort of sector of activism and speaking out to that. And that's definitely something I need to learn more about, for sure. But yeah, there's a lot of, I guess, a lot of things that we need to pay more attention to in terms of issues facing youth, especially. And I think having just more open discussions would be the route to go with that. And also more discussions about like the online sort of presence, and like social media. And I know it can be a good thing sometimes and all that, and you can feel more connected with people. And I think that painting all social media as like a really horrible thing is, I guess, not the way to go about it, but understanding the dangers and understanding, I guess, I don't know, just what's going on with that and getting youth to understand that as well is very important. What advice do you have, like, specifically to those youth, I don't know, maybe even such as myself or other, I don't know, just other youth trying to speak out and get their voices out there, and how to find your voice as well at a young age? You said you went through most of that in college, and just any like tips or advice on that?
Yeah, I honestly am very just in awe of what you are already doing. You and your friends are already doing, you know, I'm just very impressed. You know, when you were a middle schooler, when I met you talking about the work that you're doing with AAPI Youth Rising, and, you know, I actually wish I had that when I was in middle school. And so I think, like, the advice I'd want to give is to keep trusting your gut and your instincts when it comes to, like, when to speak out and when to, you know, take up a platform or when to share that thing on Instagram or Twitter or be a part of the conversation. Y'all have flexibility to navigate that in a way that is, you know, that's, it shows because y'all have been growing up with that and, like, you know how to connect to folks. And so I think, like, continue to trust that instinct. And something I didn't hear until very later on and when I was in college was, you know, I can't remember who told me, but it stuck with me. But it's this feeling of, like, when I am most afraid to speak, when I feel my heart, like, got palpitations, I'm, like, shaky, it means that the message I'm about to say is actually very important and needs to be heard. And so that's what I mean when, like, you know, how do we bridge that gap? I think, like, that's kind of like the, just like the more, the things you don't often see. And then I think, in more, in the, like, tangible ways, seek out folks that, you know, you want to work with. And I don't know how folks find each other these days, but there's so many different ways. And so if there are things that, like, I can do, particularly from my positionality, working at Teach for America or in the circles that I'm in or the networks that I'm in, and y'all are having issues, like, getting into that community, like, find the folks who can help you get through that and then get through to that. And oftentimes for me, it was a lot of my teachers and a lot of my aunties who I would be like, I really want to learn about this thing and I want to find a group that's doing this thing in action. How do I get it connected? Can you just connect me? And so I think, like, you know, think about kind of how to find the folks who are going to open those spaces up and bring you with. And I also say too, advice, like, if you realize that there's a lot of folks sitting around in a room or, like, with a table, like, the metaphorical way, bring your own chair. I love that people say that. But I do think that there's a lot that I am still learning about how activism looks for young folks. And I think y'all can also define what activism for young folks look like. And you don't need to do things the way that they have been done, especially given your context and where y'all are, especially with social media and what you're learning these days. And so I say that because at the beginning I said my activism really means, like, reflecting back on what has come before me. In some ways it meant also, like, you know, working through things that no longer work for me or for my current generation and how we want to move forward, and being kind enough to pull folks along when we can. And so I say, like, I think in many ways, trust your gut, like I said, reach out, ask for ways to be brought into the room or into the space. And also, you know, y'all are also being really creative about how your activism looks, and it doesn't need to look like how it has looked. So I would say that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for sure. I definitely stuck with the, I guess, find adults who are willing to support you, and you've definitely been one of those. So thank you so much for all that. But yeah, it's very important to find, I guess, sort of people who will stick with you, I guess, anywhere in this kind of realm of things. Yeah, I guess what kind of what kind of, I guess you work in education, right? Mm-hmm. So I think what kind of, why do you think education is so very, I guess, important for advocacy work or mm-hmm. activism, or even just the general public and combating some of the recent issues we've been facing around, I guess, racism and I don't know, what effect do you think activism has, or sorry, education has mm-hmm. on that kind of sphere of activism, and why do you think it's so important?
Yeah. Gosh. You know, I when I think about education, I think about it really in so many different ways. The first thing that always comes to mind is it's the reason why in one of the reasons why my family decided to come to leave their country, the home that they knew, to bring me into this world in this country. Because they said an education is something that people can never take away from you. And you deserve to have that because you need to make your own decisions and be a critical thinker. And, you know, education was always tied to success in my family's eyes. And you know, whatever that success looked like at the time, it really meant going to college. But what I actually started to learn was that it gave me a lot of room to just be someone who questions things, is curious. I don't think I actually knew that curiosity was a muscle that you had to build. And so I learned how to do that in school. And then I also saw that, you know, the doors that opened for me were vast. When I was a part of the, when I was learning and connecting with other students and my teachers, and to your point, I found a lot of adults too, who supported me, actually who still support me to this day, just mentoring me and guiding me. But I do think, you know, in my core, I understand too that like education in the way it's built right now is actually not built with folks like me in mind all the time. And so it is, you know, oftentimes built for our more affluent white peers, and the ways that it's navigated shows that, you know. And I think about my brother again. I said he never graduated from high school, but he actually went on to get his GED. And I saw kind of like the ways that that shifted his life trajectory and his life outcomes, how hard it was for him to be, you know, be seen as like a valued person within society. And I think like that actually, it shouldn't matter. But I knew that I had to change that. And so I think that's why like education for me was like, here are the doors that opens, but here are the ways it's not working for the folks who look like me and who look like my brother. And so we need to make sure that that changes, because the folks going to school now, the folks who are engaging in education, are going to look more like us not too long from now, right? And so I think like that's the impact that like education has had on like activism, is I think it like gives us a common language to talk about a lot of this work. So I think it helps us to know that like when we are taught the full history, when we are taught about what has come before us, when we are taught the truth in many ways, that when we tell the full story about the histories of folks who have built this country, or like come here and learn about the history of resistance in our country, it helps us to then like improve our activism. Like in many ways, it helps us to be more nuanced. For me, it has helped me to like understand how hard it is to continue to build movements that continue to get invisibilized. And so mm-hmm. I think getting that story out there, and in many ways, the work that's happening right now with like inclusive curricula or Asian American Pacific Islander history in schools, the requirement to teach that, it is waking up more folks to what has happened in the past. And it shows too that Asian Americans have always been in the fight for equity. And I think that like reminds me that like, oh, right, I'm not doing this by myself. But now I have tools already at the ready to take it on in the way that I want to move forward with it.
Yeah, definitely resonating with me. For sure. You can do this. And at this time, I'd like to thank you so much for being here. It's been great talking to you. Definitely a lot of those issues and statements really resonated with me. And this is such an incredible conversation. And I'm so grateful that you shared your time and wisdom. And I'm sure our audience has a lot to think about, just like me. So thank you so much for doing all this. And thank you all for joining.
Yeah, thank you so much, Mina. Thank you especially to you. And thank you everybody who's viewing out there for joining us today and engaging in these questions and reflections.
To. It was truly so powerful to see just two women really sharing so much wisdom together, especially Soukprida. And also, we got to give a shout out to little Mina.
I mean, what?
I wish I was that cool in high school.
Right?
Not only does she have that activist heart, but she, and this is from a two-time Emmy-winning TV journalist, quite the interviewer, if I do say so myself. So again, thank you so much, ladies, and let's hear it for them in the comments for sure.
All right, everyone, we are at the end of our program, and we have a lot of people to shout out and thank for putting this entire show together.
First off, a big thank you to our Youth Equity Council. These high school and college student volunteers reviewed all the workshop proposals and selected the ones that you saw today. A huge thank you to all of them for volunteering their time. They help us make sure that youth voices are centered in the entire planning process. Next up, we have all of our speakers, facilitators, presenters, and performers who were so generous with their time and wisdom. This is the heart of what makes Changemakers Summit a special experience, being a place that brings together all of these incredible leaders.
We also want to thank our sponsors. They are the reason we're able to provide this entire conference experience for everyone. Their support of our mission and our community is so deeply appreciated. An extra shout out and thank you to our silver level sponsors, Character Media and Sephora.
Also, a big thank you to our community partners. These are organizations and leaders who helped us amplify and get the word out about Changemakers. We know we are so lucky to be surrounded by so many organizations driving change across the country and the world. And it is only by tapping into our collective impact do we drive change.
Finally, a huge, huge, huge thank you to the Changemakers Steering Committee, made up of members from Hate is a Virus, Act to Change, and Stop AAPI Hate. They've been working on this since June, y'all, volunteering their time for hours and hours every week. None of this would have happened without them, and all of them are truly inspiring people. Super fun being your host today and co-hosting with you, Jackie.
Yes.
We hope you are feeling inspired and activated and empowered to deepen your activism.
And I want to leave you with a quote from one of the biggest civil rights icon in our community, Yuri Kochiyama. She said, "Our ultimate objective in learning about anything is to try to create and develop a more just society than we've ever seen. And I feel like all of you watching today have done that, because you've learned from so many different facilitators and speakers, from their stories, trials, and tribulations, and you get to carry that with you tomorrow." Mm-hmm.
Today has been a full day of learning, which means tomorrow is the start of that work. And we are so excited to follow you and see the more kinder, more inclusive, and more just society that you're helping us build every day.
Again, thank you so much for spending your day with us. I'm Jackie Fern, this is Rachel Lako. We would love for you to follow us on social media at Jackie Fern and at Rachel.Lako.
Yes, and continue to support the amazing organizations Stop AAPI Hate, Hate is a Virus, and Act to Change.
Thank you so much, and we will
see you
guys
next week.
Later.
Bye. Salamat.
Salamat.